has had nothing but calumny and lies told about it since it was first passed 2 years ago. Tomorrow will be the anniversary. Now, not speaking in a partisan manner, but someone who knows a lot about it, is the Director for Health and Human Services, Marjorie Petty, who will be our first speaker.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, thank you all so much for the opportunity to be with you all today, and thanks for your enthusiasm. As was mentioned, we're celebrating the second year for the healthcare law, and I couldn't be happier about the opportunity to be part of an administration that has forwarded and helped pass this law. Many of you may know that the first president ever discussing it was Franklin Roosevelt, and Nixon worked very hard to get the healthcare law passed. So now we have the healthcare law, which has been in effect now for 2 years. Many people think they're still waiting for it to happen, but the reality of it is much has already been in place. For example, the first year it was in place, those seniors who hit the donut hole received $250 for that year. Last year, in fact, I've got some Texas figures as well, not just national figures. Last year, 2011, those people that hit the donut hole, 50% of their costs were reduced for pharmaceuticals. Now, let me just tell you how that affected Texans specifically. This is great data for you all. In terms of the prescription drugs, 22,000 people that were on Medicare in Texas received $250 that first year that the health care law went into effect. Last year, there were over almost 211,000 people with Medicare received a 50% discount on their pharmacy costs. That was a total of $640 worth of savings for their drugs, for a total in Texas, for Texans, of $134 million worth of savings on their drug costs.
Hello.
That's not for a name. Well, the exciting thing for me is, you know, you hear a lot of cacophony, a lot of discussion about health care, but I can tell you, people are talking about health in a way they never would have talked 15 years ago. I had been on a business trip to San Antonio, went to Love Field and took a taxi back to my office, and the taxi driver had a bowl of apples in their front seat, and I said, "What's that about?" And the taxi driver said, "Well, my doctor says I need to start eating more fruits and vegetables." And I said, "Well, that's interesting." And he said, "And before I picked up any customers, I did my exercise in the parking lot of the hotel before I picked anybody up." Now, he had no idea that I was the Director of Health and Human Services for 5 states and 68 tribes. He was just having a conversation with somebody on the street. And those are the kinds of conversations that we hear going on right now. People taking personal responsibility, people taking advantage of the preventive health care resources that are available with no copay, like mammograms and colonoscopies. Let me tell you how many Texans have also taken advantage of that for preventive services. Those that are no longer having to deal with the lifetime benefits that insurance companies previously put on health care, 7 million Texas residents right now. Almost 2.7 million of them are women. 2 million of them are children. And those are people that have been on insurance that no longer are going to be restricted because insurance companies are being held more accountable. Those are Texas numbers. Might mention too, many of you know, anybody have grandkids that are like under 26? Okay, they are eligible to receive insurance on their family's insurance up until age 26. Let me tell you how many Texans, how many young adult, over 300,000 young adults in Texas have that resource now available to them because of the health care law. 300,000 young Texans can be covered by insurance. So we've covered young adults, that's in effect right now. We've covered the donut hole, that's in effect right now with the $250 check, and then the reduction by 50% with the phase out of that donut hole happening in 2020. We mentioned preventive services. Over 2 million people with Medicare in Texas have received preventive services at no cost to them. That's over 2 million. Those that are on private health insurance have also gotten preventive services up to about 3 million Texans. So as you can see, we're talking a lot of numbers here, but when you think of every one of these numbers has a personal story behind it. Somebody whose life has been saved, somebody who had an early identification of cancer and was able to get treatment, a young person who might have had asthma and been bumped off of their family's health insurance under 18. The other advantage of the health care law right now is something called the pre-existing condition insurance plan. I see lots of nods. You guys are so well educated. You all could do this talk. But the pre-existing insurance plan, there are 4,000 Texans now that are on that plan that previously could not get insurance. And there are people that may have some sort of a pre-existing condition that an insurance company said, too bad, we're not covering you. At a time when that's when insurance was needed the most. And that coverage can include diabetes, blood pressure. It can include bipolar, both physical and behavioral kinds of challenges that have meant insurance companies would not cover people. 4,000 Texans are now covered with the PCIP as a result of the current health care law. The 80-20 rule, this is another great thing that's happened. The 80-20 rule means that insurance companies are held more accountable for their administrative costs. So high salaries for CEOs, whatever is raising that administrative cost to sometimes as high as 40% of the premium, insurance companies can no longer do that. They are held to 20% for small businesses and 15% for large businesses. And the interesting thing is, this year, insurance companies were monitored to see if they contained themselves within that 20 or 15%. If they didn't, they are responsible for rebating or sending money back to their insurance holders. What did happen was Texas applied for a waiver and said, wait, we're not sure our insurance companies can sustain that kind of a 20% limitation. And the federal government reviewed all the information, and there were a lot of companies basically that are at that 20% now. And there was no actual evidence that there would be any insurance companies leaving the market if they were held to that 20% administrative costs. So part of what we've already talked about are three key things that are an important aspect of the healthcare law. The first is to make healthcare more affordable. No co-pays for preventive measures. To make healthcare more accessible. Texas has had over $180 million worth put into workforce training to help expand the resources and the workforce availability in Texas, to the tune of $180 million. So more accessibility for people, and also holding insurance companies more accountable, where they cannot exclude people with young people under 18 with pre-existing conditions. They have to be held accountable for holding down those administrative costs. and they cannot limit lifetime benefits anymore. Those are just a few of the exciting advantages as a result of the health care law. And so I just want to thank you all for being here to celebrate with us, to celebrate the good news. You know, one of the things that I laugh about regarding the PCIP, the pre-existing condition insurance plan, you know, they've said no to a lot of people. One of the groups they said no to was young women that needed prenatal care, because they were saying that being pregnant was a pre-existing condition. Well, if you look at it, you know, in some regards, that's exact. You took the words right out of my mouth. She said, actually, being a woman would be considered a pre-existing condition. So, ladies, we are not going to be discriminated against anymore. Now, I'm a little past the stage to be pregnant, but I will not have any higher premiums than men will now, and none of you will, as a result of the health care law. The focus, of course, is 2014, where there will be exchanges that are available so that the 50 million Americans who have not had any insurance up to now will be able to go to a marketplace that looks like Travelocity.com, except it's Travelocity for insurance. And they'll be able to look at what resources are available, compare their costs, pick the best plan that works for them. Many people that currently have insurance they love, terrific. You get to keep it, no problem there. But this is an expanded resource for those people that up to now have not had the opportunity for insurance coverage. So I appreciate so much the fact that you all are willing to be here to help celebrate this. And, you know, I love the dialogue. I don't think we should be the least bit frightened when we have questions that are raised or challenges that come up. I say bring it on.
Yes.
So thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Let's hold our questions, and we've got a couple other speakers. Okay, then we'll have questions. And can you stay?
Absolutely.
So this is our expert.
Do you have any handouts of any type?
Well, there are some over here from others.
Oh, for other resources. Okay, good.
We have a champion. We have a champion for health care and for senior rights in general, and that is Congresswoman Johnson. She has a new YouTube video that just went on today in which she addresses Congress and tells them that women will no longer be treated as a pre-existing condition.
Yes.
And her representative is here, Colin Clayback.
Hey.
Good to see you again from the prayer breakfast. We just saw you a couple weeks ago. Like Gene said, I'm calling with Congresswoman Johnson's office, and as kind of Marge was mentioning, it's a neat thing to be here on this day before the second anniversary of the health care bill. The administration and her whole team has done an excellent job. I have a personal vested interest, as we all do in this room, but I think it's cool because the first time I met Gene, one of the first times, we were doing an event. We were celebrating one of the big anniversaries for Social Security. And I think that this bill, this Health Care Act, is going to be celebrated like that 40 years down the road. And I think it's cool that I'm going to be able to say I was working with Congresswoman Johnson and played a role in making sure that seniors and people like my brother when he graduated college and couldn't find a job right out of college, had health care. And so I think that's, you know, personally something that really excites me about being here with PS today. Now, somebody asked about handouts. I brought some handouts from Congresswoman Johnson's office, and as Marge, off the top of her head, could rattle off some of those numbers, there were a couple here that if you guys live in the 30th Congressional District of Texas, there are some specific numbers that really bring it home. In a district that's about a little under 800,000 people, this bill has provided 9,100 young adults health care insurance. It has provided 4,500 seniors have received prescription drug discounts worth over $2.8 million. That's 620 per senior. 54,000 seniors in the district receive Medicare preventive services without paying any copays. Without paying any coinsurance or deductibles. 18,000 children and 80,000 adults have health insurance that covers preventive services without paying any copays, coinsurance, or deductibles. 520 small businesses in District 30 have received tax credits to help maintain and expand health care coverage. And $3.2 million in public health grants have been given to the community health centers, hospitals, doctors, and other health care providers in District 30 to improve community's health. Now that's bringing it home, and I really want to point out those figures. As Gene mentioned, the Congresswoman has a YouTube page. She just put up a new video, fighting for women's rights, fighting for the health care bill. She was on Martin Bashir on MSNBC today, talking about it a little bit. Well, she was supposed to. She kind of got sidetracked. They got her talking about something else, but she was supposed to go on there and talk about the health care bill. And so, you know, we're sending updates on what she's doing in Congress. I know I talked to a couple of you guys who said that I'm overloading your inbox. If you want those, talk to me afterwards. We'll get you on the mailing list, make sure everything. And this, on the cover page of this handout, is her statement that will be released to the media tomorrow. And this is her statement on the second anniversary of the Affordable Care Act. In 2 short years since the enactment of the Affordable Care Act, there have been historic advancements in our nation's healthcare system. With this legislation, young adults have access to their parents' healthcare coverage. Seniors have access to free annual wellness visits. Small business employers can receive tax benefits to provide health insurance for their employees. And patients with pre-existing conditions will be covered in 2014. Insurance companies will no longer be able to terminate women's coverage when they get sick or pregnant, and seniors have more options to receive care. Under the Affordable Care Act, 86 million Americans are receiving free preventive services such as checkups, cancer screenings. Seniors in the donut hole have saved $2.1 billion on prescription drugs and an average of $604 per senior. Texans are saving more than $1.3 million in health care costs, which is an average savings of $640. And over 200,000 Texans are directly saving on Medicare prescriptions. As a registered nurse, I understand how critical these benefits are. Patients now have more freedom and control over their health care choices than ever before. As we celebrate the anniversary of the Affordable Care Act this week, we should reflect on the progress made in this country and acknowledge how this legislation has been able to provide health care to millions of Americans. Sincerely, Eddie Bernice Johnson, member of the United States Congress. Thank you, guys.
I hope you'll convey our gratitude and our love for Congresswoman.
Certainly will.
I want to acknowledge Leah Witherspoon is on the table over there. Lewis Fulbright, the red shirt here. And particularly, Judy Bryant, who organized this event, pretty much organizes everything that we do. This is the day before the second anniversary of the Affordable Care Act. We celebrate today because we have won some tangible gains, which you just heard about. And we celebrate because it didn't get handed to us. We worked for this. We fought for this. We were out on picket lines for this. We sweated in the summer sun for this. So it's ours, and we do not intend to give it up. We celebrate because we know the truth. Even though the nastiest, dirtiest, lowest, vitriolicest campaign has been run against it ever since it first was passed, first signed. We celebrate because we are needed. Because we're in a town that is so low rated on health care, we're 264th out of 306. And even Fort Worth's better than that, they're only 258th out of 306. We celebrate because we have a champion for seniors' rights and for health care in Congresswoman Eddie Reese Johnson. Of District 30, which is the district that we're in right now. We are cautioned, though, because next week, the Supreme Court of the United States will hear arguments against the health care bill, against the health care law. Nothing good has ever come from the majority of this Supreme Court. They did their best to make a president out of a nothing. They tried to make people out of cold-blooded corporations. And we would not be surprised if next week they try to make insurance companies into gods. The Texas Alliance for Retired Americans resolves today, here today, that we will stand up for our health care benefits and for all senior benefits, and we will fight. We are not afraid to fight. We relish the fight. We celebrate the fight, and we are not giving up for Texas seniors. Thank you.
Yes. Bravo.
I would like to present our Community Action Network Director, Marty Alvarado. It is her job, her assignment, to sign up everybody for Texas Alliance for Retired Americans. And the sign-up sheets are over there on the desk.
So everybody sign up. Make
Here's
my
Marty.
Job easy.
Well, Gene, you didn't tell me I was going to say anything.
You're on the
spot. You didn't tell me I was going to talk. I'm glad to be here. Deborah was saying that she knew me, and I'm thinking maybe she knows my sister. And we look alike. Having them question and saying, why not me? And why not fight for our rights or whatever belongs to us?
Right.
So that's what I'm going to be working for. I'm going to be going to, and I know that some of our organizations have used the preventive steps because I've heard of a group of ladies that just go out and do their exercises, they go to get all these benefits, but we still have a lot to do. So, thank you, and I'm hoping that I serve you well.
Marjorie made an effect on the national because every time they send us something, she says, where is it in Spanish? And she's right. We need that Spanish in here in Texas.
In that regard, yes, we do have these items in Spanish. And for information, there's a website called healthcare.gov that is also in Spanish. You can click 3,000 different clicks to personalize it to you. And what comes up is what insurance is available around here and what the cost is in Spanish. I will leave This is in English, but we have these in Spanish as well.
Okay,
yep.
And I'm going to ask
you for
our website.
That'd be correct.
Healthcare.gov.
Now let's take comments and questions from the audience. And I know that Leah, for example, has had some firsthand experiences.
Yeah, I got this. I was fortunate to speak in front of Jeff Henslin's office when we were protesting the Social Security problem. I went on Social Security this year in August, and there's a month I had lost my job, so there was a month when I didn't have anything, except Medicare kicks in, fortunately, the first of the month that you turn 65. So I turned 65 on the 20th of August, but it kicked in on the 1st of August. So because of the Health Care Act, my medication for my diabetes and my blood pressure was almost free. Also, I was able on December 7th to change to a Medicare cover that doesn't cost me anything. All of the co-pays are paid, but I don't have to pay a premium for it. And that's been a real big blessing. Plus, most of my medications are now $7 instead of $45 or whatever. So I can almost live on Social Security, not quite, but almost. But it's just been a blessing to me, and you know, I'm going to be one of those people under the bridge if they do away with Social Security, but I don't intend to live up to it.
Thank you, Liz.
She answers my question before with the handout that Eddie Bernice Johnson's. Okay.
Who else has questions or statements?
Grace has something.
Grace?
To say about Grace Agbon.
Yes, I'm Grace Agbon. My name is Grace Akbar, and I have been a teacher in DISD for 40 years, so I care about our children. I just retired. Hallelujah. I am subbing at a school where I taught 25 years, Robert T. Hill, and the predominant group there is Hispanic. Beautiful children that are being abused by our system of poor education. There was a quote that said something like, you can determine the stature of a country by the way it cares for its children. And I really deeply believe that.
It's
and our children.
It's handicapped. Hubert Horatio, not
what now?
That's Hubert Horatio, not Priest Quote.
Okay. And I do you know it exactly
and
the way
and
the children
and
the said?
Children.
Because
and handicapped.
And
children
elderly
and
handicapped. There are three groups of their children, elderly and handicapped.
Right. And it's an embarrassment to me, who used to stand as a little Girl Scout whenever the TV came on and the Star Spangled came on, and I stood, even if I were alone, to see the way we just don't care for our children as we could and should, as the wealthiest, most advanced country in the world, children with asthma, children with other needs, children who are being labeled as ADHD, ADD, and not being served well. And I get the Children's Defense Fund emails, and they were talking about, they have two little children who sing, a song about the affordable health care and how it will, and I meant to bring the little lyrics to share with you because it's so cute, little four-year-old singing about how the affordable health care will make their lives better. And we need to make their lives better. They are our jewels, our treasures. I have a 25-year-old grandson who is just on that edge. And I thank God that we can now get him health care this last year. He's still in college. So his mom and dad, she works for Child Protective Services very hard. His dad is an uncommon man, but a common laborer. But has the ability to put all five of their children into some kind of health care for a while. And that means so much to us, so much to them. And I thank God for it. The thing that I liked about the Children's Defense Fund website is that it gave us all of the statistics of how many more children now are being covered with affordable health care than would have been covered before. It's amazing. Why would we not take care of those children? Then they said something about child defender, and I'm saying we need a cartoonist to put a little uniform on him, affordable health care, child defender, to come through and defend our children in every way possible. There's nothing else that we can do better than that. Thank you very much.
Not going to get Marjorie Petty every day for the authority, actually, on questions. Tom?
I'm ready for Congress against Jeff Hendrick in the 5th District, which is right here. And the Republicans today in health care are challenging what we have on the basis that it's too costly. And we of course, have set that aside on the basis that it's everyone is in it. But do you think that in the future that maybe we should start to push for trying to get the health care where it's covered by, or it's not covered by the insurance company, to get them out of the equation?
Single payer.
Our Congress has been indoctrinated not to touch that because of the way the money is spread in Congress at the present time. So we know that. That has to change too. Well, I just wonder what you thought.
Well, actually, I'm not supposed to be talking about what I think other than what I told you earlier, which is where I'm in concert totally with what exists right now. All the benefits and so forth. And of course, what evolved was what was possible to move the country forward with the existing opportunities that we had, which right now is substantial and it is transformational. It is dependent on the current market with the current insurance program and the modifications of that. So I'm grateful for where we've moved this far. And you know, it may be an incremental step, we don't know, but the important thing is to hold the ground at where we are now.
Well, I agree, but I'm just looking ahead.
Yeah. You're a pioneer, huh?
Ms. Petty is constrained by the fact that she actually works for the government. She's not here to campaign for anybody. And actually, the Alliance for Retired Americans can't either, because they're 501c3. George?
Yes, what I wanted to know, basically, which I haven't heard any numbers, how much is the cost of a family of four? Has anybody, I'm sure they've figured it out, a family of four to be covered with their health care under the Affordable Care Act? Now, and the other part of that question, which I've heard people say that premiums have gone up since the Affordable Care Act, is there any truth to that?
Well, there are several measures that are in place. In terms of increased premiums, one of the things that is in place, and actually Texas got a grant to review requests by insurance companies for premium increases. The reality of it is there is a responsibility for containing premium increases. If anything goes over 10% increase, it's the opportunity for every state to review that and make certain that the insurance company has strong financial basis on which they're making that increase or claim of increase. But I think the government has been very effective in putting the spotlight on some of those insurance companies that have 30% premium increases and so forth. And there are examples, many examples of states that have done that and then ratcheted back. You know, the insurance companies said, okay, you know.
We tried.
Yeah, exactly, we tried. So the reality of it is there's been containment on premium costs. Certainly with the Medicare, there's been a reduction on Medicare costs of a percentage. It's about 1% reduction in some of the Medicare Advantage costs. So what you see is the opportunity for that cost containment. And many people have said, why did we look at healthcare, the healthcare law? Why was it even necessary? Bottom line is, many of you may know that from the year 2000 to 2008, the cost of insurance to small businesses increased 85%. So many of the small businesses that had that treated their employees like families were in a bind offering insurance. If you look at the increases over time of healthcare costs, they're not sustainable as part of the gross national product. So the economy, the economics of healthcare really needed a dramatic change, which is what's been provided with this healthcare law.
Okay. Any other questions or comments or statements?
Yes. Well, piggybacking on what you said about the increase, my husband works for the city of Dallas. 10,000 employees, you think you could get a good insurance. A few years ago, we were paying $1,000 a month for health care insurance. And we still had co-pays for doctor's visits and all that, and pharmacy. They went down. I mean, we pay, you know, 500 and something now. But we don't have pharmacy benefits until we reach a $2,800 deductible. And I had 4 prescriptions that went from $85 a month to $485 a month. And those 4, I had to drop 2. So, I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, and the city employs, what, 10,000 people?
Other comments, questions? Okay. Next week, we're going to do something on voting by mail. Because a week from tomorrow is the first day to make applications for vote by mail. Now, you can't do it unless you have to be disabled or over 65 or going to be out of your home county during the election period. But we're going to plan that out after we have our cake, finish our celebration. So, for now, let's have some cake. All right. Thanks so much. Almost 4